Hey there, amazing audience who've joined the Revolving Time today. Get ready to embark on an unforgettable adventure with us. Subscribe now, and let's uncover the hidden secrets and truths together. Life has a curious way of throwing unexpected curveballs our way, doesn't it? Well, my friends, today's story is published by the Wanted Writer. Husband and wife suspected each other, so they set a trap to catch them cheating by doing this. I hope you will enjoy this. Neil Marsh drove toward the Imperial Hotel. He smiled to himself. In just a few hours, he would be rid of his cheating wife. The trap had been set, and it would be sprung this afternoon. Yes, this day would be a real awakening for an adulterous spouse. Neil was 44 and a handsome man. He had dark wavy hair that had yet to see any gray. His height of 6'2" carried his 210 pounds well. He had expressive eyes and a warm smile that he used in business and in social life. He was successful in business, being a partner in a well-established distribution company. And even though he was a junior partner, George Gregory would retire in the next few years, most probably allowing Neil to take the helm. By that time, their exporting operation would be in full swing. Yes, things looked good for Neil Marsh. He thought back over the last 6 months. He had begun to notice a difference in his wife of 20 years. Vicky was still an attractive woman, maybe even better looking now than when they married. She stood just over 5'4" tall and had long blonde hair. Her blue eyes could sparkle when she was happy and her smile could light a room. Was it just familiarity that had caused their love life to fall away? Vicky had asked if she no longer exited him. That is why she said she stated going to the gym to work and look better for him. Yes, that was 6 months ago, but thing had gone downhill. It was the little things, the small changes. The way she sat and brushed her hair every night, and the new lingerie she purchased. In fact, snooping, Neil found several thong panties he had never seen Vicky wear. And speaking of panties, the way she hand-washed them every night before bed. She had given the excuse the washing machine ruined them too quickly. Vicky had even commented she was going back to basic cotton panties as soon as these were worn out. Wore out. Neil had to laugh. Who is Vicky trying to kid? She wore them out every time she left the house. He wondered how long she wore them. He smiled with the thoughts of catching her at the Imperial this night with her panties off. All was in place and the trap would close. Neil realized he owed a lot to Wellington Styles and his detective agency. 3 months earlier, he had been approached by a man as he drove out of the parking garage. The man stopped him in the exit drive as if asking directions. He handed Neil a photo of Vicky at what appeared to be a hotel door. The man told Neil if he wanted to discuss the matter to meet him at the coffee shop on Middleton BLVD and Clark Street. With no further words, the man turned and walked away. Neil was shocked, but as he drove to the location, he remembered the subtle changes in his wife. Yes, the signs were there. He had noticed them, but hadn't connected the dots. So what did this man want? Neil was angry, but had time to control his temper before he arrived at the meeting. He found the man sitting in the coffee shop waiting. Neil approached. "Mr. Marsh, I see you are interested enough to come and meet with me." "Yes. Wouldn't any husband that was handed such a photo want to know what was going on?" "If you will sit down, Mr. Marsh, I'll explain. But first, do you want anything?" "No, I just want to know why you handed me a photo of my wife outside a hotel door." "Let me introduce myself. My name is Wellington Styles." Neil just looked at the man, for the name meant nothing to him. "Of the Wellington Styles Detective Agency. We specialize in unfaithful spouses." "You mean to say my wife is having an affair?" Neil asked to confirm his suspicion. "We don't have all the evidence yet, but we are working on it." "Why did you come to me?"
"I was hired by the spouse of the other person. They want enough evidence to ensure they get an uncomplicated divorce. You know, no messy trial, no hassle over assets."
Neil smiled. Yes, it would be good to be rid of a cheating spouse without having to divide hard-earned assets. He nodded his understanding. "What I am here for is to first enlist your help,
and second to extend an offer. I'm listening, Neil responded. My client will share all evidence with you if you will split the cost. How much will that be? Mr. Marsh, we are not cheap. And to get what we want will cost several thousand dollars. Right now the bill is just over $5,000, and it might more than triple that before we are through. What you are saying is it could cost me $7,500 to get the evidence. I'll say this, if we haven't got it by then, we won't ever get it. I'm not guaranteeing anything, but I'll say we won't go past that amount without your approval. But win, lose, or draw, you pay. I see, then it's a gamble, Neil thought out loud. Yes, it is, but so is life. But with your cooperation, it will be much easier and less expensive. But if the operation is given away, the affair will stop before we get all we need. They will just stop this affair. Cheating spouses never really stop. The individual will just hold off for a while and become more cautious. I see what you mean. If Vicky gets tired of this man, she might be faithful for a while till she finds a new one. And if she works it right, it will take me a while to even suspect. Now you understand why I contacted you. I only did it after discussion with my client. May I ask your client's name? Sorry, I can't do that. I have tired that in the past, and the husband got angry drunk and went to the other man's house. That blew the whole thing and caused everyone a world of problems. Us included. So you see why I can't and won't tell you the name of the other man. Yes, I guess I see that, but I assure you, I wouldn't get drunk and do anything rash. I know. But you might mention his name not meaning to, if you got angry. We tend to not think clearly in the heat of the moment. I need to think about this. I hope you understand. I do fully. I would be worried if you agreed on the spot. That would make me believe you are impulsive. We don't need that in our operation. Here is my card. Call me in a day or two. Update. The man left a card for Neil. He put money on the table, pushed his chair back and left. Neil looked at the card. It was simple, W. Styles with procurement under his name. The card had two numbers. One listed as office, the other as mobile. Neil fingered the card and thought of what he had just been told. That evening Neil was just a little distracted, but Vicky didn't seem to notice. She chatted about her day at the gym and window shopping. As she rambled, Neil had a wicked thought. What would Vicky do for money when he dumped her? She had always been a stay-at-home wife. True, she had a college degree in liberal arts, but had never used it. She had no work experience. Vicky hadn't even written a check in the last 5 years. She left all the financial obligations to him. She asked for cash when she needed it, or just used plastic. Yes, Vicky would be in for a rude shock. Neil laughed. Vicky stopped her story and asked what was so funny. Oh, I'm sorry, honey. I was just thinking of a funny thing at work today. So you weren't paying any attention to me. Well, I'll have you know some people like to talk with me. She got up and left in a huff. That only made Neil smile all the more. How was she going to feel when he was not there to talk to anymore? Not there to pay the credit card bills or dish out spending cash. Yes, Vicky Marsh would be truly up SHT Creek with no paddle. The next day, Neil used his computer to check on this Wellington Styles and Company. They had quite a website, but none of the numbers matched what was on the card. What was going on, Neil wondered. On a hunch, he checked the numbers on the card through a reverse directory. He found no listing for either number. The only other thing to do was call. W. Styles' office, came a female voice. Is Mr. Styles in? Neil asked. May I ask who is calling and the nature of the call? She asked professionally. Neil Marsh, and it's about our meeting yesterday. Thank you, Mr. Marsh. I will check to see if Mr. Styles is available. A few seconds later, the woman was back. Mr. Marsh, I am sorry to say Mr. Styles is busy. But he says there must be some mistake, for he didn't meet with you yesterday. Oh, I see. Then it was just my mistake. Sorry of the call. Neil hung up. What was really going on, he wondered. He couldn't get it out of his mind, the photo and the suspicion. He called his home to talk with Vicky, but got no answer. That was not totally unusual, so Neil tried her cell phone. There he got her voicemail before the first ring. Her phone was off. Neil tried to work, but that proved impossible. He was sitting at his desk, debating what to do when a package arrived. His secretary Florence Grant brought it in. "Mr. Marsh, I brought this in because it was marked personal and urgent." That brought Neil back from his thought. He was not expecting anything, but he took the parcel. When he was alone, he looked at it. He didn't recognize the return address. He put it aside. Where could Vicky be at this hour of the morning? Finally, to get his mind off his wife, Neil opened the envelope. It contained but a single sheet of paper. He read it. "Don't call from your office phone. Find a payphone and reverse the last two numbers on the card." Neil read it again. That sounded too much like cloak and dagger to him, but he wanted to know just what his wife was up to. He left for an early lunch. Finding a payphone was not easy. He called the proper number. It sounded like the same female voice. The woman didn't ask his name, she just put him through to Wellington Styles. "Sorry about the runaround, but I didn't think to tell you not to call from your office. Too many chances of you being overheard, and gossip travels fast in that environment." "I see, so what should I do?" "Go and purchase a prepaid phone. Keep it handy, but out of sight. When you call in, we'll have your new number. That way I can leave a voicemail without fear of anyone else getting it first." "Good idea, and what else?" "First, I must know if you're willing to pay your half." "Yes, I have thought about it, and feel it's the best thing to do. Who knows if I would have ever caught her otherwise. You would be surprised at how easy it is to spot a cheating spouse. They always give themselves away. But then you have to catch them." "I'll make this brief. I'll meet you at the same place today for you to sign the agreement and to get a deposit."
"Deposit?"
"Yes, we'd like 1/3 down. That will be $2,500.
"How will you pay?"
"I don't know. How should I pay?"
"We don't need cash, if that is what you're thinking. We can take a credit card or a check. We have several nondescript names we use."
"I'll be there with my checkbook. What time?"
"Say about your normal quitting time. Don't want to arouse suspicion."
Update 1. Neil went there at 4:40 and found Wellington waiting. He had two copies of the agreement, which he had already signed. Neil was impressed. Why would any wife think she could get away with adultery over a long period of time? How foolish can some people be? "Mr. Marsh, you make sure you put that paperwork in a place it can't be found. We have put a lot of work into this, and you have an investment too. I know you will be cautious, but still a word to the wise." Neil thought about the words of Wellington Styles. Yes, he would be cautious. Too much was riding on this. He placed the papers under the spare tire in the trunk of his car. Vicky never drove his Mercedes. She didn't even have a key to it. No, for some reason Vicky loved her Toyota. She had elected to keep it when Neil offered to purchase her another. What a fool she would turn out to be. Neil went home with a smile. Vicky noted his good mood and commented, "Oh, just a big deal coming my way. I don't know when I'll close it, but it will be a real winner for me."
"No, don't both, Neil. I'll do that."
"No problem, Vicky. I'm just as anxious as you to spend some time together. I feel I have been neglecting you lately," Vicky said under her breath.
"Yes, you have been, for a long time."
To Neil she said, "Neil, you have had a hard day. You don't need to do housework. I clean up in here. You just go make a drink and relax."
"Okay, honey. But I got the clothes already picked up.
I see the clothes hamper is empty. I'll just carry these down to the laundry."
"No, don't do that. I'll handle it."
Neil smiled and said, "It's no bother. I'll see you downstairs." Neil went to the laundry room. He was in luck. There were several pairs of panties already in the hamper. He sorted out the ones Vicky had worn that day from the tangle of her clothing. The crotch was sticky. He placed the panties in a Ziploc bag and put another pair in the jumbled mess before he dropped them on top of the other dirty clothes. It was then his jealousy hit him. He had to get a drink to calm down. He rationalized that confronting Vicky now would not be the best thing to do. If he wanted to truly be rid of her, he would have to let the trap close tight. If she thought he was wise, she would break off this affair for a while, till things cooled down. Vicky came down just a few minutes later. She went straight to the laundry room. Neil watched, and she seemed to relax when she searched her clothes. Neil had to bit his lip and act as if he didn't notice. When she came out, she asked for a drink. "Vicky, you aren't ready to go, are you?" "No, Neil. I just wanted to get those clothes in the wash. Oh, and I left my club card in them. That's why I wanted to bring them down myself. I was in such a hurry, I just didn't clean out my pockets." Neil handed her a drink and smiled big. "I'll bet it was more than your pockets you wanted to clean," he thought. Wellington was surprised and happy with the soiled panties. "Now we have to set her up. I confirmed the man she's meeting. She meets him on an average of twice a month. Always on Wednesday. The guy is an investment counselor and works appointments all day Wednesday. Now we just have to set it up so we know where they are going in advance. That way we can get in and set up cameras. And you know it might help if I set some cameras up in your house. And we could record the phone conversations too." "How will you do the cameras?" Neil asked. "Leave that up to me. I don't want you to know anything about them, or when I set them up. If you do, you might tip her off. And don't go looking around for them. I'll make arrangements to have them installed next Wednesday, when we know she will be busy. I'll meet you here Wednesday morning on your way to work. I'll get the key then." "That's not a problem. I have an extra with me." "Great. Now do you have an alarm system?" "Yes, we do, but Vicky seldom sets it when she leaves. She forgot and set it off too many times. We just use it at night. I'll need the code just in case. We don't want the alarm going off by mistake." The following Wednesday, Wellington confirmed the cameras and a phone recorder were installed. Neil was so caught up in the suspense of the situation that he felt like a spy. He was going to almost be sorry when it all came to an end. Almost, but not really, for he had no use for an unfaithful wife. At home, Neil tried to act normal. He didn't know if it was his imagination or if Vicky was just a little ill at ease. She was, and she prayed Neil didn't notice, for she was seeing the changes in her husband. Update 4. Then a week later, a trip fell into his lap. George came in and asked Neil if he could go to La and meet with the representatives for their client from Singapore. "I hate to ask on such short notice, but I need to go to Chicago. And then I might have to travel on to New York. I'll be gone at least a week. That is why I'm asking you to go in my place. Depending on the outcome of this trip, there might be a new CEO in line." "Really, George, you aren't thinking of retiring, are you? I mean, you are the founder of the company." "I know that, but there comes a time when you see the end coming. When do you find that there is more to life than work?" Neil called Wellington on his way home. He had to stop in a parking lot to have the time to discuss the events and how they might be used. "You say you need to meet some men in law from Singapore. That's what my boss asked me to do. And you will be gone on Wednesday." "Yes, it looks that way. Okay, here is what might work. You see if you can move the meeting to Monday. That way you can be through by Tuesday and on your way back. But your wife needs to think you are going to Singapore. Have you secretary purchase you a ticket to Singapore routed through LAX? When you get to LA, just cash the ticket in. Make sure your wife sees the ticket. She will know you are out of the country. We have studied your wife's cell phone records. The man always calls your wife around 9 in the morning on Wednesdays. We just need to make sure her cell won't work. If she is at home, she will have to use the home phone to call him. We'll then know their plan for the day." "How can we make sure she is home?" Wellington asked. "I'll call her on my cell phone and tell her I'm expecting an overnight message. She will need to be home to accept it and open it for me. I'll have a friend send me some reports from Atlanta." Neil offered. "The only thing we need to do is disable her cell phone. Get it for me tonight. I'll have a man at your door at midnight. He'll need about 5 minutes to rig the phone. When he does, all we have to do is call her number and press in a code. That will drain the battery. She will have to use the landline. I can do that, I think. But Vicky is a light sleeper. You have any sleeping pills? Yes, Vicky got some several years ago from her doctor. She was having trouble sleeping. She hasn't used one in a while. I'd say the last 6 months or so. Say, do you think it's because of her affair? Might be. People act differently when they are keeping a secret. I'll make sure she's sleeping tonight. I'll tell her I'm working late. She goes bed early when I do. She says so she won't disturb me. Outstanding. So you go to lay, and then you get yourself back here as quick as you can. When I know where they are staying, I let you know. If you come in Tuesday night, you can just stay at a hotel close to the airport. On Wednesday, we can make arrangements to get you to their rendezvous. If we pull this off, we'll get all the evidence we need. The plan was set. Neil did his part. He got the ticket to Singapore and made sure Vicky saw it. He had her take him to the airport. He told her he wouldn't be back till Friday at the best. He also said that with a time difference, he might not get to call her in the evening. They would be on opposite hours. The evening in Tampa would be the working morning in Singapore. Neil suggested he call early in the morning, say around 8 or 9. Vicky quickly agreed. Off Neil went. He arrived in Leh and met with the customers. Neil was delighted the meeting was more to get acquainted than anything else. He found the deal had been signed a week earlier. That sounded a little strange, but Neil took it in stride. He delighted in taking the customers to dinner and a strip club. He even managed to get one of the four men a blowjob. Tuesday afternoon came, and Neil bid them farewell, promising to visit Singapore soon. He was back in Florida by 7 that night. He made 2 calls. One was to Vicky, telling her of the urgent package that was on the way. Neil instructed his wife to wait for the package, then call him as soon as it arrived. She could open the envelope and read him the figures he needed. With the next call, Neil learned that George had left Chicago. He had called his wife to say he was at the airport heading to New York. He promised to call that the next day and tell her where he was staying. Update 5. Neil stayed with a friend that night. He didn't sleep all that good, but he was rested the next morning. At 10, he got a call from Wellington. The plan had worked. They had the location of the meeting. His wife had made reservations. The place was the Imperial Hotel. Their check-in time was 2 p.m. Neil was delivered to a car rental agency minutes later. Yes, Neil was delighted with how all of this was going to work out. He parked his car and checked in. He wanted time to clean up and get a little rest. It was going to be an exciting evening. When he arrived at his room, he was met by a hotel manager. They told him there had been a mix-up. The room they had given him was out of order. To compensate, Neil would be given a suite at no extra charge. He thought it just keeps getting better. An hour later, he was entertaining in the lavish suite. He was thinking of the shock on Vicky's face when she was caught red-handed. Luckily, he would have a shoulder to cry later that night. At 2 that evening, Vicky walked into the Imperial Hotel. She looked around the lobby for a familiar face. She saw who she was looking for. She nodded to him and went to the desk to claim her room. She was a little nervous, but it would pass. In just a few minutes, she was in her suite. It was just one floor above Neil's. Neil got the call. She's here. Now we wait for the man. If we read this right, he will give her about 20 minutes to get ready. It's their way of keeping distance between them. He appears to do these things often. Fine. I'm not far away. I'll be in the lobby in 20 minutes. Neil hung up. He smiled and said, "It's just about over." Neil found Wellington in the bar. He had a stool that gave him a good view of the elevator bank. "You just missed the guy. He went up about 2 minutes ago. Good thing too. Your wife might have shown him photos of you. We'll give them time to really get cozy. Then we'll make a house call. I have a key to the room, and it's loaded with camera gear. I have a man watching. He'll call me when we have what we need. Now have a drink. You look like you need one.
Thanks, I think I will.
Not every day that you expose a slot wife.
Here, here, brother. Wellington hoisted his glass.
I'll drink to that. I get real satisfaction out of this. You see, my wife was a cheat. I suspected, but she caught on and cleaned me out. It cost me a lot, but it did put me in this line of work. I want to make sure nobody gets shafted like I did.
The two men drank and made small talk as they waited. On their second drink, a man walked up to Wellington.
Got it all, boss. Here's a copy of what we've recorded.
The man handed a DVD disc to Styles.
I guess this is all we need.
Blake, you go back and clean up. I see you at the office.
By then you can have it all compiled on one disc.
Sure, boss, all I need to do is add these last two.
And Jake and Thomas are in the hall upstairs.
Well, come on, Mr. Marsh, let's complete this little operation.
Without any more words, the two men walked to the elevator.
Wellington sighed.
I never get used to this part, really, but it has to be done.
Part of the business.
Neil didn't respond. In the hallway stood two large men. They acknowledged Wellington and took up a place, one on each side of the door.
Wellington looked at Neil.
You ready?
Neil gave a sarcastic smile.
I sure am.
Wellington Styles handed a key card to Neil.
You do the honors.
Neil opened the door.
There was no one in the sitting room, but they heard the sounds of love making coming from the bedroom.
Neil put his finger to his lips and tiptoed in.
Neil followed.
They made their way in and looked at the door to the bedroom. It was slightly ajar. The sounds were louder.
Neil got a little sick at his stomach, hearing his wife in such lovable abandon.
Damn, she never did that with me, the thought.
They moved to the door.
Wellington looked at Neil and indicated he should open the door.
Neil did and was disheartened with what he saw. He stood in disbelief for over a minute.
When he came to his senses, he looked at Wellington Styles.
The man had a disgusted look on his face.
Turning to face the sitting room, he saw Vicky, the two men from by the door, and a stranger. He was trying to understand what was going on when Phillies rushed in.
Neil, what was so urgent you called me down here?
She then realized something was amiss.
Maybe I should leave? Phillies mumbled.
No, please stay for the end of the party, my dear and loving wife. The voice startled both Phillies and Neil. For the voice was none other than George Gregory.
George, you're in New York.
I'm afraid not, my dear. I came back early just to attend this little gathering.
Now I think these men have something for you.
One man stepped forward.
Mrs. Phillies Gregory, you have been served.
He handed her a large envelope.
The second man did the same to Neil.
Wellington Styles shook his head.
Man, you are one dumb as asterisk. You were trying to catch your cheating wife when you flew in yesterday.
And where did you spend the night?
In your boss's bed, with your boss's wife.
And to compound it, you had to screw her again in the suite upstairs.
We couldn't believe you would be so dumb and arrogant.
But when we heard you invite Mrs. Gregory to help you through your misery, we just had to arrange to tape it.
I guess you recognize the video in the bedroom.
But this is not right. You were out to catch my wife cheating on me.
Well, Mr. Marsh, what I actually said was I needed help to catch a cheating and adulterous spouse.
You took that to be your wife.
You played along and even paid some of the bill.
But what about the panties?
Wellington looked at Vicky.
Mrs. Marsh, you want to explain the panties?
Sure. Would be glad to.
Neil, the semen you saw in the panties was real.
Then you were ducking around.
Neil almost shouted in triumph.
No, I wouldn't stoop to that. What you saw was yours.
The last time I let you use me, I went to the bathroom and collected your deposit in a small medicine bottle.
That was not a pleasant experience.
You're having me or trying to catch your slime?
Afterwards, I hid the bottle in the freezer. I just knew you would stumble onto it.
I was really nervous ever since we started this.
And the closer this came, the more nervous I got.
I guess you picked up on that.
George spoke up.
Neil, I have known about you and Phillies for the last 18 months.
That shocked both Neil and Phillies. But how? We were so careful, she asked. A man has his ways of knowing. When I was certain, I hired Mr. Stiles. He had all we needed within a month, but I wanted to get things in order first. Then I thought of Vicky. I wanted to protect her too. She deserved to claim something from her marriage. Be paid, so to speak, for her faithful years. I had her investigated for 6 months to make sure she wasn't part of a swinging couple. When I knew she was in the same boat as I had Mr. Wellington contact her. She didn't want to believe it at first, but the many videos had their impact. Neil looked at his wife. How long have you known? With a little pain in her voice, Vicky replied, I guess I have known in my heart for the last 10 years. For a long time, I overlooked it as just wild seeds, so to speak. You always came home to me. But when I saw the videos, I knew that eventually you would leave me for a younger woman. So I did what I had to do. I'm sorry, Vicky. Let me make it up to you. I'll never be unfaithful again. We have 20 years together. Let's not throw them all away. No, Neil, it's far beyond that. Phyllis looked at her husband. George, can you ever forgive me? Yes, my dear, I will forgive you. But I will not forget. You see, I plan on moving on with my life. You see, I was not in Chicago for medical tests like I led you to believe. I was there selling my portion of the company to a foreign corporation. The funds were paid in Europe and are now in a Swiss account safe and sound. Now for the bad news, Phillies. I sold the house with the company. You will soon be evicted. How can you do that, George? We are married, and I have rights to community property. True, you did, but you signed them away. Do you remember my new will that you signed? You only read the part that made you my sole beneficiary, not the clause where you released all claim to my company shares till my death. I'll fight you in court. You can't kick me out of my own house. George smiled. Phyllis, poor dumb Phyllis. I always thought blonde jokes were just that. But you seem to fill the role of a dumb blonde. Do you remember when you wanted the kitchen remodeled? You don't ever cook, but you wanted the newest gadgets. Well, the paperwork you thought was the contract for the improvements was actually a quick claim release for your share of the house. I had it recorded over a year ago. So I sold the house along with my shares in the company. I'll get a lawyer tomorrow and freeze all our accounts. Phyllis, I wouldn't do that if I were you. And why not? She demanded. All that is left is $25,000. The rest is gone. If you freeze the account, you won't even have that. You should receive eviction papers in a few days. I would hate to see you on the street, so I didn't leave you destitute. You won't get away with this, you bast. I'll see you in court. Phyllis yelled. That is a possibility, but it might prove difficult. You see, I will leave the country tonight. I have always wanted to tour Europe, and that way I'll stay close to my money. And since I took everything I wanted when I left for Chicago, I have no further need to stay. Now I must bid you farewell. But George, what will happen to me? Phyllis begged. George Gregory looked at his wife with a twinkle in his eye. In the words of Clark Gable, frankly, my dear, I don't give a damn. Or something like that. Oh, and Neil, what I said about a new CEO when I got back from Chicago. Well, he's already in town. You should meet him in a day or two. Without any more to say, George turned and walked out the room. Phyllis was in tears. Wellington looked at one of the men. Is the suite upstairs clean? Should be. Want me to look? Yes, and take Mrs. Gregory with you. She can spend the night if she wants. The room's paid for. Neil looked at Wellington. You know, I'll have your video throw out. And I'll sue the hotel for invasion of privacy. How so, Mr. Marsh? Wellington asked. You bugged my room illegally. That should bring a handsome settlement. Neil was trying to bluff. But Mr. Marsh, you were not in your room. You were in a suite paid for by your wife. Remember how you were escorted to the suite as a comp? But you falsely represented it. You said it was the hotel's doing. Guess we'll leave that to the lawyers. But even if you do get it thrown out, we got enough of you and Mrs. Gregory in her home to make a full-length movie. I guess we will see. I'll have your license for this. Wellington Styles laughed. Bigger and better men than you have tired. Vicky looked at Neil. I have a confession to make. This man is Fred Williams. I have been meeting with him every other Wednesday for over a year. She paused to let that soak in. He is an investment counselor. You remember how I always wanted cash for my wallet. The pedicures, manicures, and hair salon visits. I lied. I did most of that myself. I had plenty of time. I didn't like daytime TV and all. What did I do with the money you asked? And it was about $20,000 over 10 years. I invested it. I played the market. I did well, if I say so myself. That original sum is not over 60. Fred here has helped me invest and move the money I have taken from our marriage. What are you talking about? Vicky smiled. You remember the new life insurance policy I took out? You complained about all you had to sign that day. You should have checked them closely. You signed a full power of attorney. I had access to all our accounts. I even took that $156,650 you never told me about. And I took out a second mortgage on the house. I collected all my equity. Now I have a tidy sum, a paid-for car, and all the furniture I want from the house. The movers were there when I had to call you with that silly information from the overnight parcel. I had them take a break outside so you wouldn't hear them working. I'm not as generous as George, I'm afraid. All I left in each account was $1. I just didn't want to leave you with nothing. I also maxed out all your credit cards. I took cash advances and put it in our joint account before I moved the money. Boy, the interest on those advances is almost 30%. I'm so glad I have cards of my own and not saddled with your debt. Vicky, you can't do this to me. I deserve something. Oh, I left you the house and your car. Now you know why I wanted to keep my Toyota. It's paid for and in my name. Right now it's downstairs ready for me to leave the city. You can run, but I'll find you, Neil threatened. Vicky didn't respond to that. She just looked at Fred. Say goodbye to Norma for me, Fred. And give my love to Toby and Beth. I always wanted kids. I'll miss you all. Looking at Neil. There are some things you don't know about me. I met Norma Williams 3 years ago when we took a class together. We became friends. I met Fred, her husband, later. He helped me a lot. Now the class we took was to obtain a concealed handgun license. I guess I never mentioned that, did I? I practice often. I carry a Sig Sauer 9mm, and I'm proficient with it. I intend to leave the state and start a new life. I will pick a state that allows handgun licensing. I will do my best to hide my identity. If I ever see you again, I will assume your intentions are to harm me. I will act accordingly. Vicky Marsh had a cold look as she made the statement to her soon-to-be ex-husband. It was not a threat, it was a warning. Looking at Fred, she smiled. Fred, remember Norma carries a Sig .357. Fred smiled back. I'll remember that, Vicky. You take care and stay in touch. Wellington Styles and his man stayed with Neil as Fred escorted Vicky from the building. In an hour, she was well on her way to her new life. Thanks for watching. Remember, Revolving Time exists because of your support. So take care of yourself and see you soon with another story.